visitor to the university, Honorable Chancellor, sir, permit me to stand on protocol already established to read the citation of the 49th Convocation Lecturer of the University of Nigeria. Right Honorable His Excellency Chibike Rotimi Amaechi. Inspiration and perspiration are often considered passion that ultimately produces the genius. Yet at times, it is the congruent collaboration of adventure, best teacher, that prompts our prince to vacate his vestibule and venture into the gaping gulf. If he returns victoriously, he is celebrated. Today, we engage with the 49th Convocation Lecturer of the University of Nigeria, our compassionate compatriot, an indefatigable late worthy Nigerian, a native of Ubima, Ikwere local government area of River State, graduate of the University of Port Harcourt, former president, national.
Feminine. Initially needed to define themselves to the outside world in relation to the University of Nigeria. They needed to prove that they were not offshoots or branches of the University of Nigeria. The assumption then was that Nigeria had only one umbrella university with multiple branches. From the onset, therefore, this university was founded on the noble ideals of nationalism, national unity, and the promise of national greatness. I am made to understand that for a long time, whenever graduates of this university, interacted with graduates from other first-generation universities in the country, there was always a contest of superiority or primacy. Why did Super Graduates boasted jovially that they are graduates of the older university in Nigeria? Why see the others as products of provincial or personal centers? The others will rebel and accuse the Super Graduates of undue arrogance and appropriating mentality. Let me register my protest as one of those who rebel against the tyranny and arrogance of pioneer universities, like the University of Nigeria so far. I'm a proud product of a third generation Nigerian university, a very innovative and adventurous center of learning and cutting edge research in the humanities, social sciences, and oil related studies. I'm a product of the University of Port Harcourt, where I took my first degree in literature and English. I have constantly held my own as someone who received first-rate humanities education under some of the finest literary and humanities scholars that our nation has produced.
Be careful.
In fact, one value of the type of humanities education I received prepared me for the various roles I have had to play in public life.
He can stay there.
This is a multidisciplinary exposure which prepared one to be an all-rounder, equipped to solve social problems in a balanced way.
It's okay.
Likely to be drowned or intimidated by the primordial status or the overbearing and presumptive nature of the person of Nigeria. Now that we have a whole gamut of federal, state, private, specialized, and purely commercial investors on an industrial scale, the University of Nigeria and its graduates can happily take their front row seats, and bask in their pioneering status. The Super Graduates can justifiably celebrate the dignity and tradition that age confers on universities, if nothing else. But in a competitive world in which the frontiers of learning continue to expand exponentially, no institution can relax on its path growing. Innovation and rapid technological advancement make institutional complacency a loss. It's a matter of dignity.
What is guy doing?
Indeed, in the nature of universities, tradition counts for a great deal. The tradition of any university is usually the consolidation of its founding philosophy into a guiding inspiration and enabling mantra. This is what guides the university's research, teaching, and general academic direction over time.
Go back to that.
Successive generations of staff and students come to imbibe this tradition in their interactions and academic endeavors. It becomes the driving force of their pride in the institution through which they pass. Thus, Harvard, Yale, MIT, Oxford, and Cambridge are not just fancy names. They are traditions rooted in history and founding philosophies like the University of Nigeria and so on. The great state of Africa, who founded this university, was not a man to be lost in the quest for tradition and enabling philosophies. His love for knowledge and tradition knew no bounds.
Still his name.
Therefore, from the onset, he powered this institution with an enabling philosophy which is embodied in this motto. It simply states that the overriding objective of this institution shall be to restore the dignity of man. Set against the nationalist struggle against colonialism and its informing racism, this was a heavy mandate for a university. But Dr. Zikwe was first and foremost a man of infinite love for learning. In his generation, time and place in African history, knowledge and education were perhaps the most important means of validating the dignity and humanity of the black man. The black man and woman hold it to his race and to humanity to prove beyond reasonable doubt that he had the ability to acquire education himself from slavery. Beyond emancipating himself from slavery and colonialism, the black man had a valid civilization and a worthy contribution to make the march of human civilization. Nowhere else would the impact of such contribution be felt than in the world of learning and the pursuit of knowledge through cutting-edge teaching and research. That single attribute was all that was required to disprove his supremacist assumption of racism and colonialism. From his essence, therefore, the great state of Africa endowed his university with a civilizing and liberationist ideology and mission. As it were, the acquisition of western education and learning in all disciplines and learning is one of the reasons why we are gathered here today. The changing challenges to human dignity. For me and for the purpose of this lecture, the operative word is dignity. The dignity of man and woman will be the sum total of all that makes by so many factors. Beyond the classic categories of racism, colonialism, deliberate denigration, and enslavement. It is now centuries since the formal end of slavery. It has also been decades since the last African colonies have secured political independence to become sovereign nations. It is true that we still have vestiges of economic independence as burdens and services and the major indices of human development. The population of the country has grown exponentially from 5.98 million in 1970 to over 201 million in 2019 and about 210 million today. Similarly, our per capita per head has grown from $284 in 1970 to $2,149 today. But the purchasing power of the current higher figure is less than what the smaller figure would buy in 1970. Only an average of 20% of Nigeria's 1970 population would be regarded as poor. Increasingly, however, even the most avid races are now a bit reluctant to display their prejudices openly. In fact, after the official police lynching of George Floyd in the streets of Minneapolis and in the era of Black Lives Matter, it has become fashionable for non-racist individuals of population to make a show of not being racist. Product levels have been hurriedly changed, huge corporations have begun to review their racial quotas for employment and career advancement. That is some progress on the matter of restoring the dignity of the black man at least. Interestingly, the world has come to the rude awakening that every act of indignity against black people is a further degradation of the dignity of the racist themselves. Racism is no longer just a blight on those discriminated against, but more a devaluation of the dignity and humanity of the racist as well. The wind has come full circle. This is why every major sporting tournament in the world is now preceded by the symbolic taking of the knee to show our common solidarity in the campaign against racism and all forms of discrimination. That is how far humanity has come on the matter of human dignity. There are still many treacherous rivers to cross. We now live in a world where a variety of factors have arisen that constantly reduce the dignity of our common humanity. The tribe of humanity that is in desperate want of dignity in one way or another now traverses national, continental, I jumped this because of time, tackling poverty and inequality. The prevalence of poverty has been recognized as one of the greatest threats to our national unity and national security. In my mind, I see the poverty burden as the greatest threat to the situation of the dignity of the national person. Poverty has become a leveler and a unifier, even in time of political and ethnic fundamentalism and divisiveness. Come to think of it, there is no distinction between the poor man or woman in Maiduguri and the one in Port Harcourt, between the poor woman in Yenagoa and the opposite number in Tokoto. They all speak the same dialect of Nigerian language. They are hungry, homeless, and sometimes hopeless. I have repeatedly said that poverty is an issue about which I do not need to be lectured by anyone. I grew up in the inner city of Europe in Port Harcourt. I know about a padded home with a whole family living in a modest apartment. I know the pangs of hunger when the little available has to be shared among many siblings. I know the uncertainty of a future where school fees will not be paid on time. I know of the misery of a Christmas that will pass without new clothes or gifts from parents, not because they love you any less. the personal conviction that of all the challenges facing our nation's transformation, none is more urgent than the scourge of increasing poverty and the threat of mass inequality. Nigeria must attack and conquer extreme poverty and inequality, or the poor will allow the rest of the children. That can account for this NSAS and all that. Let us take the threat of mass poverty seriously and elevate inequality to the status of a perennial national emergency in the years ahead. Nearly all the troubles that confront us as a nation can be traced to either direct poverty or the fear that the number of poverty will rise one day to devour the fortunes of the rich and prosperous. Perhaps the reduction of desperate poverty should be the first step in fostering genuine national unity in the years ahead. Only then will most Nigerians speak the same language and understand each other better. Left alone in their present poor and hopeless state, people will tear each other apart and feed on each other's end traits in an endless war over nothing in particular. Yet, let us not allow politics and partisan power play blind us to the origins and causes of our poverty trap. For the avoidance of doubt, let me state that the desperate poverty that we have today has its roots in dispositions that came before the Buhari administration. Specifically, our epidemic of mass poverty dates back to the turn of civil rule in our country. It is unfair to give the responsibility for the prevalence of poverty and inequality on this or any one administration in the history of the country. The Buhari administration has correctly identified increasing poverty and inequality as one of the major impediments to national development. The Buhari administration at least 10 million Nigerians from other poverty I believe that the various ongoing social welfare schemes organization will ensure the achievement of this objective and that successful actions will take on the mantle of poverty reduction as a capital objective of state policy. Previous government efforts have also contributed in reducing poverty over the years. This includes the community bank, rural banking, and rural bank network, directors of employment, net fund, directors for roads and rural infrastructure, mass transit program, the Kenapay program. In spite of some of these schemes, however, the burden of poverty in Nigeria continues to weigh heavily on the nation. It is either that these schemes are not well thought out, or the magnitude of resources committed to them is too meager to make any significant impact. Global perspective. For the avoidance of doubt, I need to point out that Nigeria is not alone in being confronted by the burden of poverty and inequality. Other nations have confronted the problem with tangible results that should spare us. Let me therefore point out the strides which three countries in identical circumstances have made in the battle against poverty in recent years: China, India, and Brazil. I single out these countries because until recently they were in identical socioeconomic circumstances as Nigeria. They all used to be third world countries with huge poor populations and struggling economies. The achievement of the Chinese in poverty reduction has been equated with a modern day miracle. According to the World Bank, a total of 850 million people have been lifted out of poverty in China in the last 20 years. The poverty rate fell from 88% in 1981 to 0.7% in 2015. This is poverty as measured by the percentage of people living on $1.90 or less per day by 2011. Purchasing power parity terms. This translates into an average poverty reduction rate of 42 million people per annum. In total, the Chinese have reduced their poverty rate by over 60% of the population in 20 years. The achievement corresponded with a period of sustained economic growth. It adopted a strategy of focusing on the poorest people in the rural areas. It massively moved them from poor homes in the countryside to apartment blocks in urban areas. This is similar to the strategy adopted by the late Lee Kuan Yew, the Prime Minister of Singapore, in tackling poverty among the strong brothers of Singapore. This led to rapid urban renewal and uplifting of the standards of hygiene and living among the former slum dwellers with a corresponding economic impact. They could now leverage the market value of their new apartments to raise capital. Let me go to India. According to United Nations reports, in 10 years, 2006 to 2016, India has lifted a record of 273 million of its population out of poverty. This has been achieved through a series of rural development programs targeted at poverty alleviation in rural areas as a priority. By targeting the rural areas, India's strategy resembles the Chinese one in general, but is distinct in being based on specific programs. There are four basic schemes in the Indian mode. First, there is the Rural Livelihood Mission, which guarantees the rural poor access to finance to increase household incomes, entitlement to rise, increase access to participation in the national economy through participating in banking and insurance services. It also incorporates participation in microcredit schemes for rural-based workers. Secondly, there is the Mahatabagadi Rural Employment Guarantee Act 2005, which is designed to guarantee the livelihood of rural people. It's an employment guarantee scheme that assures individuals of the people of 100 days minimum wage employment. Let me jump. Thirdly, there is a rural housing guarantee scheme designed to provide housing for all by the year 2022. In Brazil, the poverty reduction strategy of Brazil is guided by a desire to improve the income of those at the bottom of the economic pyramid at a rate faster than those of people at the top, and also faster than the rate of GDP growth. The result is that Brazil has been able to, in the last 2 decades, to reduce both poverty and inequality simultaneously. Between 2003 and 2009, 21 million people have escaped poverty. The Brazil National Institute of Applied Economic Research says that the country's poverty incidence rate declined from 35.8% to 21.4% between 2001 and 2009. The period during which the country's Gini index, which measures rate of inequality, dropped by 9%, the lowest since the 1970s.
You don't even know what we're capturing.
Six major policy initiatives led to Brazil's success at this level. First is the Balsa.
Are you sure?
Bolsa Family Scholarship, which provides family income support for families whose per capita monthly income is less than $47. In return, families must ensure that they facilitate their children, attend routine health programs, and ensure they keep their children in school. Compliance with these requirements is what assures people of continued participation and benefits from the program. This has helped in uplifting health standards as well as education participation among the poorest segments of the
country.
This has been complemented by radical reforms in education that aim at expanding the level of education among less educated residents. The road ahead for Nigeria. From the foregoing perspectives of other major countries, some facts are clear and
evident.
Government must confront inequality through conscious well-thought, sustained and sustainable policies. Such policies must be informed by the realities of Nigeria's situation, which I dare say remain unique and peculiar. In summary, there are areas that we must address if we hope to overcome our frightening inequality and poverty. We must see our policies from an urban-based focus. The poorest urban Nigeria is many times better off than the most well-off rural Nigeria. Therefore, we need to emulate the Chinese and Indian examples and focus on the rural majority if we must end the increasing marginalization of our rural compatriots. Our current land title and tenure system have continued to consign our rural landowners to peasant holders of acres of land without commercial value. We need to reform our land title system by removing encumbrances in rural land titles so that rural farmers can use such land to access credit from the banks and credit unions. The digital revolution in the world offers us a unique opportunity to use technology to reduce poverty and inequality. Through the apps on our cell phones, a psychological inequality has been attacked. We should now use those very apps to transact business between the urban and the rural domains to transfer funds and visa credit and fire aspirations. In all of it, politics and leadership have roles well thought out. There cannot be genuine democracy in a society divided by unequal access to the goodies of life. The only possibility in that rise is anarchy, which currently stares us in the face as rival mobs and their deep talks are scrambling for primacy on how to divide the country into tribal republics and personal estates. The democratic state must rise to the occasion by taking on the challenge of fighting poverty and inequality as a matter of urgent priority. The survival of the state and its very security are implicated in that necessary fight. A poverty-ridden state with unequal access to the good life is in danger of subservient state of nature where man has no dignity and hope is a mirage. In that place, life is short, brutish, and nasty. Mr. Vice Chancellor, the visitor, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I thank you all for being the audience.
We all stand and give a resounding ovation on behalf of the congregation to the comfort of the congregation lecturer. of the invitation. After the Vice Chancellor decided that the 49th confirmation lecturer was going to be the one, we sent him a letter and I had to make an effort to see him. And without an appointment, I went to his office. It was a particularly busy and difficult day for him because he was scheduled to take the COVID vaccine. And I fear that, like most people, after the COVID vaccine, he could go home and take a rest. He took the COVID vaccine, and within hours, he was back in the office. Please, a round of applause. And when he was told that the professor was waiting to see him, he said, "Yes, I'll see him." And for all those that were waiting for him to see him, he saw me first. And I'm not talking about 6 a.m., 8 a.m., I'm talking about 8 p.m. He was in the office when I left at 8:15, and there were still people waiting to see him. So thank you so very much. The Vice Chancellor will make a presentation to the 49th Confirmation Lecturer on behalf of the University of Nigeria. The Vice Chancellor.
Tell him you are offline.
In commemoration of your lecture to the university today, congratulations. He says, His Excellency, Right Honorable Rotimisi Ameji, 49th Confirmation Lecturer. Again, showing that this is University of Nigeria and it's only University of Nigeria and others. This is one of the products of the University of Nigeria. This is just one of the products of the University of Nigeria. This is very good. continue with the confirmation process. Admission to higher degrees. Chancellor, sir. Persons whose names will be called have fulfilled the requirements of the statutes and regulations of the University of Nigeria to be admitted to higher degrees. I therefore call upon the respective deans of faculty to present their candidates. As the candidates are called, they stand up there and they are not supposed to come here and raise their caps and replace their caps. The dean, Faculty of Agriculture, presents your graduates.
Will the graduates from the Faculty of Agriculture rise up, please, and stand on your feet?
Please, this night. Go outside. It's in just a time. Why would we go use outside? Go use this one.
Chancellor, sir.
Right now, the board. Then I put in a year, now this one.
On behalf of the Faculty of Agriculture,
something
on the authority of Senate, For postgraduate diploma, PGD, from EKG and 12
Move, 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 move the lights. I will come back. I will come back. Let your mind don't go. No more to look at it.
I teach you the degree of Doctor of Philosophy and the degree of Masters of Science in Agriculture.